had all this stuff unhooked and moved it from back there. And I thought, since they wasn't over 10 wires, I thought, well, surely I can remember how to hook this up. Couldn't remember a thing yesterday. Had to call Jimmy Dalton and Lovell Stevens. And we still ain't got it exactly straightened out, and ain't got the monitors back, and they just hooked it up good enough we could have church this morning. If it's too loud, you can let me know, or if it ain't loud enough, you can let me know. But we just got it fixed back good enough to, and it's picking up a lot of stuff, but we got it fixed back good enough for today. But we got a lot of stuff done over the past 2 weeks, and I'm thankful for that. Appreciate you all giving and making it possible for us to work on it and fix things. And got us some new carpet down so you can shout and run and try to wear it out. Appreciate you coming this morning. And let's just get in and worship Him. I mean, that's what it's all about, is to feel His presence, to be in His presence, to let Him talk to you. I mean, you know, we're here so God can speak to us as well as us to Him. And me and Junior, we've had a lot of time to talk the last 2 weeks while we was out here. And he was talking one day about, you know, having trouble praying at home sometimes, and I said, well, you know, if you can't think of anything to say, maybe we ought to just go into His presence every day, and even for 15 minutes, just sit and listen. See if He's got anything to say. At least offer Him some time, is what I'm trying to say. At least offer God some quiet time, just you and Him. And how much you can offer or how much you want to sacrifice is up to you. But I think every Christian needs some time with the Lord each day, don't you? I think that's the reason we jump up and we take off and go do things, and we waste a lot of time because we didn't take time to spend a few minutes with Him. But I'm glad to be here this morning. I'm glad for what He's done. This is a new year. You know, I thought all older people says that time is going faster the older you get. And I thought yesterday, I thought, you know, it's really not. But we can only remember about 3 months of last year. So we think it was only, you know, like 3 months long, because that's about all we can remember of it. I think one thing that makes time seem like it's going so fast is we stay so busy. I'd say for people like in the nursing home and in the hospital and people in jail, I'd say it don't seem like it's flying like it does for us that's out here busy all the time. But you know, it is a new year, and we got an opportunity this year to do more for the Lord than we ever done before. And a lot of preachers and a lot of people that's not preachers are saying that this is going to be the best spiritual year that we've ever had. And I heard one guy yesterday on TV, you know, he was even linking it up to what has always happened after the blood moons. Of course, those have already passed last year. So he was showing in the Bible what always happened after them. And he says this is going to be the greatest outpouring, you know, of the Spirit of God. The sad part is, I mean, the Spirit of God can be moving all around you and you don't even know it. I mean, it happens all the time. Amen. You know, Spirit of God will be moving, God will be doing things, but if you're not spiritually minded, you won't even know what's going on. It just passes you right on by. So you got to be spiritual minded in order to know what God's doing. Let's stand this morning and thank Him for all that He has done. He's so good to us last year and the years before that. Father, we love You today, God. We give You praise and honor and glory. We love You, Jesus. We love You, Jesus. We love You, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that you are here this morning, God. This is your house. This is your house, God. And you have just let us be stewards over it for a time. But God, we give you the praise and the honor and the glory. Let everything that's done in this place magnify you. Let us be obedient this morning, God, to you. Lord, we worship you and praise you and thank you for all the blessings that you have supplied us with. God, we thank you and praise you. Have your way in this service. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. For a long time I've traveled down a long, lonely road. My heart was so heavy in sin, I sank low. Then I heard about Jesus. What a wonderful hour. I'm so glad that I found out he would bring me out his saving power.
can start out this New Year's Day being free. Free to worship Him, free to praise His name. Like I said this earlier, He came from a place where they continually cried, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty," continually around the throne. He came to earth to be a man and to die for us. He died a horrible death for us. And we can't raise our hands and praise Him. Thank Him. Bless Him. Oh, we need to bless His name today. He's so good to us. He's so wonderful. I thank You today. Praise You. Oh, praise You, Lord. Praise You, Lord. Praise You.
To Canaan's land.
There'll be no tears in thy eyes.
Sing too loud up there to you?
No,
it's okay. Since we ain't got no monitors, they can't hear theirself up here like normally you can. So I didn't know if it was too loud.
We watched you out, somebody say.
Yeah. Make a sign of some kind. Well, this one ain't picking up very good. Don't seem like.
We'll get lined out this month sometime. I brought holy, holy, holy. When I reach that other shore, I'll praise his name forever. Won't have to suffer anymore. There'll be no one to doubt me.
You've got pain, he's a pain maker.
chain breaker.
Yeah.
it just blesses my heart to hear Abby sing. There was a time that she was having so much trouble walking, but God's moved, and I thank you.
Difference, but they can't hear themselves. And probably would have been better if they'd all stood out here, but it was a little crowded. It's good to see that we're going to get another year, and good to have another year. I tell you, been a lot of times in my life, I never thought I'd see 2017. But God has been merciful. He's good to us. He's blessed us. We don't know what this year's going to hold, but we know who we're trusting in. That's the thing. You got to know who you got your trust in. And if your trust is in the Lord, then you're going to be all right no matter what happens. no matter what comes, everything's going to be all right if you're trusting in God. If you got your trust in man, then I can't tell you on that. I don't know. because I know what God does, but I don't know what man can do. I've never been real impressed. Have you? Have you been real impressed? They told something yesterday. Since 1948, when Israel became a nation, Israel just makes up a very small percentage, you know, of the population. They're very few in numbers. But yet the Jewish people have come out with more inventions and Nobel Peace Prizes. And it was just amazing at how small a nation, and it just showed how God is blessing them. And how God is changing things around, and they was talking about that, you know, the difference since 1948, since they went back in and possessed the land. And of course, there's a lot of fighting going on. We don't know what all is going to take place this year. We don't even know what's going to take place here, do we? And these people, you know, that was here this time last year, that's done moved. They done moved on to heaven, and they got their reward. But we still got to make it. We still got to make it. But we're going to have to be willing to make some changes, ain't we? I know I am. I don't know about you, but I know I've got to make some changes. And I've got to let, I can't do it without God, and you can't do it without God either. The changes that needs to be made. But God has promised to help us if we'll call upon Him. Amen. He's promised to help us. Amen. Bible. Anybody got a testimony this morning?
I just want to say that when that song, when they sing that at the feet of Jesus, I feel Him so much, and just His love and just His peace and joy, and it just overwhelms me. It's just, it's nice.
One of these days, we won't just talk about Him. Amen. We'll be at His feet, moment. And you know, there's so much we don't know about heaven, but I think it's going to be good. Junior told a fella a while back, he said, "This is the quietest place you ever be." He was complaining about people praising God and shouting and carrying on, and Junior said, "Well, this is the quietest place you ever be. What are you going to do when you get up there and there's a lot of praise and worship? Are you going to say, 'Lord, just send me back,' or what are you going to do?" But I think people's attitudes will change when they get there. I think, of course, we're going to have a different body, but I think they're you know, everything will be different if you get to heaven. They said about this church, you know, some of the people that donated the land, they said, and this lady that made this statement a few years ago, she's 80-some years old, and she said, "My parents, when they donated the land for this church, they didn't intend for it to be a Pentecostal church." And I didn't say anything. Of course, I wasn't the one talking to her. I was just being relayed back and forth. And I thought if they made it to heaven, they'd be tickled to death that it was a Pentecostal church. You know, because, you know, they're going to understand that worship is a common thing. They're going to understand that children of God are supposed to worship God. Amen. You know, one of the greatest victories the devil has had in America, I can't speak for other countries because I ain't never been to other countries much, but one of the greatest victories the devil has had is when he was able to quieten the church down. That's one of his greatest. And then when he was able to get people behind the pulpit that wouldn't speak the truth, he had another big victory. And, you know, anytime he can get, the devil can get preachers in behind the pulpit not to preach the truth, man, he thinks he's doing good. And he is. He is doing his job. But, you know, I don't want to be guilty of it.
No.
I want to know, don't you? I want to know what's in this word. We can seat 76 people back there right now, not counting these up here. If I can get 70 people that's hungry for God, I mean, I'd like to see it happen by the end of the year.
Amen.
I would. I'd like to have 70 people that is so hungry to know what's in this word that they just come just whenever the doors is open, they're here.
Yeah.
And they're ready to learn. They're ready to worship. You say, boy, you're stretching your faith, ain't you?
No,
I'm just telling you what I'd love to have. I'd love to have, which I've always said it, and I mean it. God knows I mean it. You give me 10, I'll go with 10. But I'd love to have 70. Because if you get 70 people in one mind, you could, if you could get even 50, if you could get people in one mind, they could get their mind upon the Lord and they could get serious about God and about what God's going to do, you'd have some power. If you can get people just to come together and begin to seek God. I said last night at the church we was at, I said, you know, here at this church we're taking on new things. We're trying to understand how the devil has power in certain areas. You know, how come he's able to have power in certain areas? How come he's able to attach himself to certain things? See, I don't understand that. I don't understand that. I mean, I know there's a reason, and I know that we're supposed to be able to do something about it, but right now I don't know exactly what to do. And probably the only way to get that answer is to pray.
Amen.
That's true.
Amen, that's right.
Probably fasting and praying. It may be the only way. That might be the reason I don't know, see. But I don't understand why he's able to have control here and there and even in people's lives. I don't understand how he's able to have control in certain people's lives. Do you? You know, seem like there's certain areas we don't have a bit of trouble with, do we? And then there's certain areas that seem like we just cannot defeat him in. Now, why is that? Why is that we can't just, if we can defeat him in one area, it looks like we say, devil, I'm going to defeat you in this area.
Yeah.
But I don't think we'll know until we start praying. I think when we start really seeking God and studying his word, I think then we'll be able to know why certain things are happening. Now, I know, I'm smart enough to know that I cannot save everybody. I cannot change everything or everybody. I'm smart enough to know that part. But I want to change and the things that I can. Don't you?
Yes.
You know, the things I have power over, I want to use that power. And as Robin was teaching, you know, we've been given all kinds of power. We've been given all kinds of power. As children of God, as sons and daughters of God, we've been given all this power. But what are we going to do with it? What are we going to do now? It'd be like somebody unloading a D-11 out there in the parking lot and say, here, Alan, you can have this big D-11. And the way they're made now, I probably couldn't even start the thing. So it wouldn't do me much good, would it?
No.
I'd have to call in somebody and say, come and explain this machine and train me for a few weeks or so and train me how to operate this machine. See, but a lot of church-going people's not willing to train. We're not willing to be trained to operate with all this power that's been given us. You know, I'm not going anywhere near where I thought I studied for, anyway. But can you imagine, just try for just a minute to picture this in your mind. Jesus Christ is walking along the old dusty roads. going from one little community to another, from one town to another, some of them bigger, some of them smaller. But he's going along, and he comes up on a blind man. He spits on the ground, makes a little mud, puts it in his eyes, and says, "Go wash your eyes." The man does it, and he comes seeing. Now, do you think that anybody got excited over that?
They sure did.
Huh? What about the service where he healed them all? That they was a multitude. How many does it take to make a multitude?
Bunch.
Well, one place, they was 5,000 men, not counting the women and children. If you got 5,000 men, you got at least 5,000 women, and you probably, back in that day, you might have had 10,000 children. But if you had 5,000 men, 5,000 women, and 5,000 children, let's just say they just had one child apiece. And the miracles begin to happen. What do you think was the atmosphere around that place? Do you think everybody was just sitting there? Well, bless God, I'm so glad they got here. Honey, it was chaos. It was chaos. I mean, if the guy you, I was almost called his name, but if the guy you was talking about had been there, Junior, he'd have been tore all to pieces. He'd have said, "I got to get out of here. Man, I can't stand all this miracles and shouting and praising God. I got to get out of here. All this racket." You know, but you know, it had to be, didn't it? When Jesus walked into the temple, or you take the story of Peter and John, when they walked into the temple, And the man that had been laying there crippled from his mother's womb, and him 38-year-old or over 40-year-old, and instantly he gets his miracle and goes leaping and jumping into the temple and praising God. Things happened, folks. It broke out. It broke out then. And it would break out today. It would break out today. Now, they'd be people that wouldn't have a thing to do with it. They'd say, "I don't believe it. Don't want nothing to do with it." But there'd be some excitement in other people. I'm ready for some excitement, ain't you? And I don't want to shout over nothing. I want to shout because something happened. Now we've always got enough to shout about. We do. We've always got enough to shout about. I mean, we can come in that door saying, "Thank you, Lord, I'm saved. Thank you, Lord, I didn't wake up this morning with a hangover. Thank you, Lord, I didn't wake up with an empty feeling in my soul this morning." You know, we always got something to praise Him for. But I'm ready for some excitement where somebody got a miracle. Somebody got a miracle. And that is God's will for people to get miracles. It's God's will for people to be touched supernaturally. Now, we talked about this too this week, wanting to be able to help people financially. I know probably every one of you, I shouldn't ask for a show of hands, but probably every one of you at some time or another, you have felt led to go and either give somebody some money or some food or some help in some way. And you felt like you were supposed to do it, and you did it. And you know the feeling you got as you was returning home or later, don't you? You know the feeling you got. It was good, wasn't it? It was good. It says it's more blessed to give than to receive. Well, that's in the natural. If God can't bless you, if He can't bless you, if you won't let Him bless you, if you don't expect Him to bless you, and you won't let Him bless you with natural things, money, land, cars, if you won't let Him bless you, you can't bless nobody. You understand that? That's easy, isn't it? If I don't have money, I can't give money. So I've got to be willing to let God bless me in order to bless others.
Amen.
Well, it's the same thing with the spiritual. It's the very same thing with the spiritual.
Amen.
If you don't have it spiritually, you don't have wisdom, you don't have knowledge, you don't know the Word, you don't know what God has done or what He will do, then how are you going to tell somebody else? Now, every one of us can testify of what God has done, can't we?
Oh, yes.
To us. We can all say, He changed me in this way. He done this for me. He's brought me to here. He done this. And we can all, we've all got a testimony. If we're saved this morning, we got a testimony of what God has done.
Yes.
But if we won't receive spiritually, how are we going to help anybody? So you got to receive all, take in all that you can take in, spiritually, financially, in every way, let God bless you. When the Word, I come across the Word in the Bible this morning, perfect, and in the Scripture it was using it in, it meant to have everything, have every all your needs met. And, you know, if we have got what we need, and more, then we can give it out. Jimmy was talking yesterday about how tiring, how it wears you out to go day after day, church after church, and just constantly giving out.
Yes.
And he said, people don't realize how hard that is on your physical body.
Yeah, that's right.
And he said, only people that's done it or preachers that's preached, they know how it takes all the energy out of you.
Yeah.
When you get under a good, heavy anointing and you just feel great, I mean, you feel just, it's just hard to understand when the Spirit of God is all over you, just how good you feel.
Mm-hmm.
And then after it leaves, it just feels like all the energy has been drained.
That's right.
And you just want to find a place to lay down or sit down or something. And you do that back and forth night after night like they do. And he said people don't realize that you need a break sometimes.
Yes.
But we got to be able to receive, don't we?
Yes.
I said this last night. I said, hang around anointed people that has wisdom. Find, you know, if there's somebody that knows more than you know, if there's somebody that has walked the walk longer than you have, and there's somebody that can help you spiritually, hang around them people. Make an effort to get to them, because it will pay greatly in the years to come. If it hadn't have been for the people that we hung around, back years ago, we wouldn't be where we're at today, spiritually. You've got to get around people that knows more than you know.
Amen.
You've got to.
Amen. That's
in order to receive. And, you know, some people are not good listeners, are they?
No.
They're not good listeners. They talk all the time. And they just, so all they know is what's coming out of their mouth.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm serious.
Yeah.
You know, and I talk too much sometimes. I know I do. But when I get around somebody that's got knowledge, and of course, see, God can show Herschel things that I don't know. He has many times.
Yeah.
And I know that by listening to him teach. Because he'll be teaching, and he'll teach something, and I've read it, but it ain't been revealed to me. Like, I mean, I just haven't got it yet. And